Greetings, I'm Haze Long, an artist and speed painter from Malaysia. Today is all about spreading Christmas cheer through art. So we will be painting a beautiful watercolor Christmas illustration in Procreate, starting from a simple coloring page. And the best part is that you can actually download the coloring page for free. Just check out the link in the description below. And now let's begin. All right, here we go. So in this file, you will see sketch and coloring. So we're gonna start by coloring in this layer. So in this file itself, you can also load in the color palette that I've prepared for this coloring page. So if you just see the color palette, this is how it looks like. It's called Haze Christmas palette, and we are going to use the watercolor brush set today. So we are just going to start with the superstar wash to lay down some color. So this brush is great for big areas, like if you just started out with the watercolor painting and you want to just quickly lay on some colors before you proceed. Once you're happy with the blue, we can move to another brush. So the next brush that we're going to use is called the dual color brush. So this brush, you need to actually load two different colors. Okay, so if you go over to classic or disc, you can see that there's two swatches here. So we would want to load the two colors that you want to paint here. So for example, I'm going to load this here, and I'm going to tap on this swatch and load this one here. So when you paint, you're actually painting with two colors. And then for this part here, I am going to paint this and this. Okay. So you can see that it's really starting to blend for you. And then once I'm happy, I'm going to switch the green one to the next yellow tone. Okay, so for the areas below here, we are actually going to make like some clouds. So let's try and paint some clouds formation using the colors that we have. Now, if you want to paint white, I would recommend that you use the eraser brush and set it to bleeding wash. Let's try to use a dabbing brush for this area of cloud here. And then let's smudge away the shapes that we don't like. So for smudging, but let's just try soft water smudge. This would give a very soft look, so be careful. If I want hard edges, I would pick the bleeding wash again. But you can see that the moment I smudge, we lose like the canvas texture or the paper texture itself. So if you want the texture again, you will need to paint over it again. This is a really great brush for blending. You can see that if I just blend it out, and it can just fade nicely. So if you can, try to use this brush to paint instead of using the smudge brush, because this way you can retain the texture. I'm just gonna go in with yellow and put in some spots. So bear in mind that we are still working in one layer. The moment we add another layer, we would not be able to get the effect that we are painting on the same paper. Okay, I'm just gonna use the blending wash. Okay, when you use any of these brushes, just bear in mind that the moment you let go, you are literally letting go of the brush and applying paint again. So for example, if I just let go and apply again, you can see that when it overlaps, it gets darker. So if you want the whole thing to have the same tone, you should achieve it in one stroke and don't lift your brush up. And then when you're doing work in an early stage like this, try to use colors that are very saturated instead of gray colors. So I want to have like some specks of blue and orange. Let's see if we can achieve that using the dual brush. So when you get to the stage that you are unable to avoid things, for example, I'm trying to define the neck, but I find that I couldn't avoid the hair. This is when you know that you need to add another layer. I'm just using leftover paint to put some dry detail. And we're just going to carefully use the blending wash to create the lips. You can try the blending wash, and you can also try the well-behaved brush. The well-behaved brush can be easier to use depending on your preference. I'm just going to start adding some blood into features. So your goal this layer is to identify a brush, one brush that you can use for the rest of the painting. without swapping brush. Just find something that you are comfortable with. Alright, so this is the second layer, and we're going to work on the background. So the first thing that we want to do is make sure that everything is bold and vibrant enough. You can use any brush that you like. You see, if I use the dark color here, you can see that instantly it just loses the vibrancy. So to maintain the vibrancy, you can lay a layer of like vibrant color first. So let's say, for example, this is really vibrant, right? And if I lay the dark color, you can see that it maintains like the vibrancy of it. I am going to use the bleeding liner to pour some bleeds. Okay, we're gonna use the dry brush. See if I can just paint with that brush itself. And I'm gonna use the darkest color and then use the dry brush to cool it down for some texture. So what happens is when you make a new layer and let's say you're painting with a lighter color, you start to cover it. But if you're painting on the same layer, for example here, when you paint, it's almost like on a multiply effect, as if the water is still wet. But if you're on a new layer, you're starting fresh and you get to keep the colors pure. So if you want to create some pure colors in this layer, you can. Okay, let's start to shade some of the background. When you're shading, be mindful that you are maintaining the vibrancy, because watercolor is all about layering vibrant colors. But don't forget that when you're painting, you're playing with soft and hard edges. So make sure that you smudge out any texture that you don't want, or if they stand out too much. Okay, let's work on the clouds at the bottom. The dabbing brush is great for clouds. Okay, now I'm gonna start building the shapes of that layer. You can use the well-behaved brush or any other brush that you're comfortable with. If you're looking for like clean, sharp lines, I think well-behaved brush is a better option. No harm building some colors here. I'm trying to create some shapes of clouds in the background. So for example, if you want a light blue and there's none here, so what you can do, you can compensate, like you pick white here and then the next swatch you pick blue here. So it's the same thing. You get in between. Okay, here's the fun part. So we're just gonna create another layer, and using the splatter, we're gonna put some splatter here and there. And then we are just going to lower the opacity down and erase some of those areas that is not necessary. So for the stars, we are going to merge the layer that you just splatter in down into background, and then we're just going to merge all the way down. You can also use my other brush pack, like from the glitter palette. We can also just use the brushes here, because the brushes here are a lot more fine and it's easier to control. So I'm just using the sparse glitter brush from my glitter brush pack. Then we're gonna go and switch back to the watercolor brush pack and head over to the eraser tool. And we're gonna erase some stars. So just try and create a galaxy that is balanced. If you're doing drips, make sure that they're really straight. So for the portrait, we would want to have another layer, and we are just going to do the skin without the hair. So for the brush that you use, make sure that you pick a brush that you're really comfortable with. And remember what I said about overlapping brush stroke, make sure you create everything within the brush stroke itself. So if you overlap, you will start to have edges like this, and use that to your advantage. Don't forget, you can also use the eraser brush to carve out details. I'm using the dabbing brush to put in some texture while I blend and model the skin tone. I'm going to create another layer and use the salt brush for this stroke, and then I'm going to erase away the parts that I don't want. Okay, let's blend up this area. When I blend, I try not to overwhelm and flatten out the shading.
So if you notice, I'm actually working a lot more on the modeling, and I'm making sure that all the shapes join together properly and it's really clear. For example, the neck is a cylinder and the face is made of pyramids and cones, and all these shapes are coming all together nicely. This all has to be really, really clear, especially where the form turns at the edges. The shadows need to be clear as well.
Okay, we can start working on the face already. So when it comes to face, it's the same concept. Work in layers, merge often, erase away if you need to see the effect. So this is a limited color palette portrait painting, which means you're only using orange and browns for the red, and yellow for the skin tone, and blue for the neutral tone. So try and just use these few colors to get the effect that you want to achieve, especially when it comes to modeling the face. You know what's going to be a huge bonus is if you create each stroke with just one go. So it will make your painting look very spontaneous. But the downside to this method is that you have to keep redoing your strokes again and again until it's perfect. We still haven't achieved that effect yet, and especially the forehead, it just looks unmodeled. So you see, I have blue shading here and I'm now using brown, and when I overlay it, it looks darker even though the two colors side by side are the same value. So this is because brown and blue is like canceling each other, so the color is like opposite. So when you layer on top, it looks like black. The chin, we gotta be careful. If we paint it too low, it looks like her chin is very long and very thick. So we're gonna go up a little bit. So same goes here. I'm gonna overlay the two different colors to get them to sort of blend in together. You can see how easy it is for me to just blend something like this. We're just gonna use the blue and base the color a little bit here. So we're trying very, very hard not to use any black in this painting and create everything out of just colors. Let's not forget the eyes. Now would be a good time to introduce some grays into the eyes so that we can see for ourselves how everything is going to look like. So this method is actually called glazing in the traditional art term, which means transparent layers of paint built upon one another. And when you look at it, at the end, you can almost see every single layer. Every time you paint, ask yourself, is it too warm or too cold? If it's too warm, then we should go towards yellow and then blue. If it's too cold, you should go towards yellow and then red. Now for the ears, we're just going to quickly carve out some highlights. So most important thing is to get started with how gray it is first, then we can judge how gray we need to tone it down. Now let's get the blues in. You can tell that I'm really, really heavily loading these areas so that it's really, really defined. Okay, now from far you can tell the whole shape of the figure, because ultimately this painting is finding a balance and a play between blue and yellow. When we are ready, we can create a new layer and start to define the outline of the hair. So I'm just gonna quickly color in an outline, something that will make it easier for us to edit later on. So this is just the well-behaved brush. I'm just going to smudge to blend it to the other layers.
Then once we have defined the main color of the hair, we are just going to paint within it using alpha lock and then define some gradients. Then we will go ahead and add in all the dark shadows using a darker brown to line all the shadows so that we have a base of shadow to work on while we shade and model our hair after this. So I have three layers, the base layer and the mid-tone, and then now I have the shadow layer. But with every layer, I actually turn on the alpha and then change the colors within each shape. So now I'm done with the shadow layer. I am going to lock the alpha for this shadow layer and change the colors for this shape.
So right now we have the shadow and also the base. So we're just gonna create a layer in between the two. So we'll work on the mid-tone now. It's up to you how you want to work for this layer, but I think I'm going to go with the dual brush and I'm gonna work pretty big so that I can just carve and erase away parts that I don't want. And we are just going to continue building this layer. Because this layer is right in between, you are affecting both layers at the same time. You're just putting a glaze to even out everything else. And you're using the eraser to shape your brush strokes. So you don't have to be very careful when you paint, which means you can work pretty fast. So these are my layers for now, waves, hair, and portrait. So we are going to create a new layer and work on the portrait. So just slowly and steadily work your way across the face, line everything nicely. At this stage, you shouldn't be doing any more shading. They should all be done already. All you're doing is just lining and doing all the small modeling. And now is also the time to put in the highlights. Carefully detail the small areas. When you're putting highlights and shadows, always remember not to kill the color. So always base first before you do the darkest blacks and the lightest white. After this, I'll teach you guys how to finish up this sketch. Okay, let's just finish up the chin and make sure it's really 3D. So I finished detailing the portrait already. So I am going to merge all the layers into one. So now we have just one layer and the sketch. So what we're going to do is we're going to alpha lock it. And then we're going to recolor this entire layer. So to recolor it, we are just going to use any brush that you like. Don't use the watercolor brush because those are very transparent. And then have your color palette ready to color. So for all the lines, just pick colors nearby and clean up. Like these areas, I don't really want any lines, so I'm just going to color it in with colors that are right next to it so that it looks as if it's not here. Just slowly go over the entire painting. This is not like a one-step thing. You still have to touch up a little bit after this, but it'll be quicker once you have this done. So here I've given a bit of double lining to emphasize the highlight and the modeling. Let's add some effects before we go back to the snowflakes. Pick a size and then put some drips. So to make this more realistic, we can use the bleeding wash. A little goes a long way, so try not to go overboard with this. So go to the layer of all the color first. Make sure it's in one layer. Head over to the eraser tool and let's use the eraser and white bloom tool brush. You don't have to be very precise because some of them are really small. Once you're ready, just erase away the sketch. If you have trouble using the eraser brush, you can also switch to the wet liner brush for the eraser tool. Create a new layer, use the splatter brush here. And then we're gonna switch to the bleeding wash to add bigger splatter. We are just going to paint in the shadow first. So just pick a blue nearby. Okay, once we are ready, we can just go over to the eraser tool and start erasing away. We have one layer set on add blending mode in order to create this glowing effect. So using the wet liner, I'm going to use the brush to paint the shadows for the snowflake, and then after that I'm going to recolor this entire layer to be a colorful shadow. Then I'm going to put a glow around this snowflake to give it a sparkly feeling. Finally, I do a check for all the other snowflakes, add some shadows and some more glow and sparkles to finish up the snowflakes and the illustration. Okay guys, thank you so much for watching all the way to the end. Remember to like, subscribe and comment down below if you have any thoughts. And I will be sharing more videos from now on. It's been a long time since I've been active in YouTube. Thank you so much. Bye.